Good evening, everybody. I'm really happy to have you all here on this World Day Against Trafficking in Persons. I'd like to welcome everyone to Let's Bring Missing Awareness to Schools webinar. I'm Lina Kejriwal, founder of The Missing. For those of you who are unfamiliar with our work, Missing Link Trust is a non-profit organization that raises awareness to prevent sex trafficking in India. Our mission is to work at the intersection of education, art, and technology to raise mass awareness about sex trafficking and curb its rising figures, impact vulnerable populations of women and adolescents. Our vision is to create a safer world for children. On this day, established to raise awareness on the issue of trafficking, we would like to take this opportunity to facilitate discussion on this issue and share our latest efforts with you. I invite Gitanjali from the Missing team to introduce our esteemed speakers. Over to you, Gitanjali.
Thank you so much, Lena. Thank you. Good evening, everybody. We've got an excellent lineup of speakers who've spent decades working in the field of anti-trafficking. Mr. Guillermo Gayarza, Mr. Sebastian Edisiri, Ms. Ananya Chakraborty, Dr. Sarfraz Khan, and Mr. Shekhar Mehta. I'd like to invite our first speaker, Mr. Guillermo, the Vice President of Partnerships and Law Enforcement Training at the International Center for Missing and Exploited Children, also known as ICMEC. He's been running ICMEC's law enforcement training program to equip prosecutors and investigators alike with knowledge and tools to better protect children from online sexual exploitation. I'd like to invite him to share with us how we can better protect children from sexual abuse and exploitation. Thank you for joining us, Mr. Guillermo. Over to you. I think you're on mute.
There we go. It always happens to us. Good afternoon, and thank you so much for the kind invitation. My name is Guillermo, and I'm at the International Center for Missing and Exploited Children. In my short 7 to 10 minutes, I really want to talk about a very important issue, and as we know, is trafficking and sexual exploitation online. Let's face it. The past 18 months have been a really crucial time for all of us, all over the world, because the world is in a health crisis. Having said this, this has given us a new challenge because children, adolescents, and teenagers are spending more time at home more than ever. And that means they are playing video games, they're having access to the latest technologies, and they're going to school or at home. At the same time, child sex offenders, predators, are also working from home. They're spending more time at home than ever. This opens a vulnerable space for children because, as we know, technology is now a way that offenders are reaching out to children. In the latest reports that we have received, because of COVID, reports have gone off the roof because, again, children are spending more time at home and child sex offenders are accessing latest technologies to abuse children. And when we talk about abuse children online, we're talking about the worst of the worst images of children that are being trafficked and sexually abused online. We're talking about hundreds and hundreds of thousands of images circulating the internet right now. I want to make sure that this is not a victimless crime. We always think because it's an image, because it's a picture, there's not a victim behind. But most of the time, these are victims. And every time their image is shared, distributed, or saved as, that victim is getting re-victimized because you could never get that image off the internet ever. You can delete it from social media, you can delete it from anywhere else, but there's always going to be a copy somewhere else. So never lose the fact that this is not a victimless crime. When we talk about the offenders, who are the offenders? It's not most of the time you're a stranger person. A lot of times it's someone close to the family. It could be a religious, it could be part of the religious leader, it could be a coach, it could be a nanny, it could be a male offender. When I say male offenders, 99.999, they are male sex offenders. there has been female offenders, but they have assisted in the act of the abuse and the traffic. I think moving forward, I think the need to have better legislation is crucial to the fight against online child exploitation. We have to align ourselves with model national response systems. And what does that look like? We need to focus on the justice system to make sure prosecutors, judges understand the crime, but also understand the way technology plays a part of the crime. We have to focus on prevention, education, and awareness. And I commend MISIN because this is why we're here. We're here to talk about the issue. We're here to educate ourselves and learn that there are resources available. Investigation, we have to work with law enforcement to there so they're better equipped on how to handle these type of cases. So they're better equipped on how to deal on how to the victims and how to work with the offenders as well. As part of the national capacity, we look at different components. It's a two-pronged approach. We have to look at reporting mechanisms such as reporting portals, reporting hotlines. There has to be services for the victims as part of the reunification, but also, believe it or not, there has to be services for the offenders. We need to understand why they are abusing children, why they are attracted to children. We also have to have research and data collection. I think a lot of the times, including India and the United States, there's not enough data or research to understand how big the problem is, let alone in one country, but also globally. Because once we have a better understanding of how big the problem is or how many cases are being reported, say in the States, we can understand where we can allocate resources. We need our policymakers or decision makers need to understand that it's a problem and it's not just a national problem, it's a global problem. There has to be also, as I said, training for justice officials, but not just on the law enforcement. Teachers, academia, research is a multidisciplinary approach. We as NGOs cannot do all the work. We have to work with industry, with our public-private partners, and also with other NGOs all over the world. And as I said, because of COVID, one of the challenges as well that traveling sex offenders are not traveling right now because of the travel restrictions. This has opened another challenge because what the offenders are using these days, they're using streaming services and third-party merchant applications to have access to trafficked children, the worst of the worst crimes online. Now they're being streamed online. So that's another challenge that we need to continue to work with financial industry, but also with the gaming industry. So as I said, it's a global picture, but I think if we as a society, we educate ourselves of the challenges, but also the opportunities that are out there, I think we can make the world safer for our children. We often say, let's protect our children because they're the future of tomorrow. But let's think about that. Let's protect our children now because this is how they're living right now. And we have to protect them every day. So I think with that said, I think there's a lot more that we can discuss. I just want to make sure that we're not in this alone. We are a global community and we are all facing the same issue. And we have to work globally to address this issue because this is a borderless crime and we have to work with one another. So I think I didn't pass my 7 minutes, but I think I tried to hit to the bottom point. So happy to discuss further. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mr. Guillermo. I think you really sort of set the context for the webinar that we're having here, emphasizing on awareness and all the different ways in which we must act now. Next, I'd like to invite Mr. Sebastian Ediseri, the Director and CSO at Deloitte. He's a security and fraud investigation professional with over 40 years of relevant experience in security investigation, digital forensics, and training. He's closely associated with the safety and security of children in the digital world. He's also a consultant trainer with ECMEC for law enforcement training on investigation of computer-facilitated crimes against children. Thank you so much for joining us, Mr. Ediseri. Please go ahead.
Thank you, Lena and MISIN team. I'll be spending some minutes on child sexual abuse online, a growing pandemic alongside COVID-19. And before commencing my topic, let me say this, my talk is mainly based on the Indian realities, as I support many what you call law enforcement groups in fighting this pandemic in India. And also that while I belong to Deloitte for employment purpose, this topic is totally nothing to do with Deloitte, and it's all on it's all my presentation or my talk. And let me get on to the contents part first. So what I'm trying to cover in a brief span of about 7 to 8 minutes, role of COVID pandemic in increasing the child sexual abuse activities online. What are the some of these tools that they use, and why they prefer that, and how can we help control the abuses? So to start with, some of the points as have been cleared by as been covered by Guillermo, closure of the schools and introduction of virtual learning platforms have been one of the main reasons, at least in India, to see that a lot of child sexual abuses have come up. And now because of that, you can get a lot of or an increased presence of number of vulnerable children every day online, very, very young ones, right from KG, UKG or standard one onwards, are these days available exclusively online for more than 5 to 6 hours, maybe about 4 or 5 hours for the learning and remaining time for their own interested activities, etc. Because kids are no longer able to go outside their house for any activities, including playing, etc. Then you now have, at least in India, the government of all states and provinces have upgraded the internet capabilities. You find in most, even some of the remote cities, you are able to see the 2Gs upgraded to 3G, 4Gs. And the infrastructure in itself has been improved by private and government collaborations. And the children, or maybe the teachers also to some extent, are ignorant about ignorant about cyber safety that they should be taking care of, that has added to it. Then there is also, like as Guillermo has been mentioning, about increased demand for material online because of the lockdown. And in India, we can also see that a lot of underreporting of the child sexual abuse related issues, because many times police, you can't go to a police station, and maybe the parents or teachers or the caretakers are unable to walk down to the police station for raising complaint. And still there are some of infrastructural challenges with respect to reporting online. And you also do not have or enough time for the community support services to see that the vulnerable section of the society, the children, are taken care. And also there are a lot of reduction in the availability of specialized resources that is addressing child sexual abuse concerns. So these are all some of the areas in which it has impacted, or it has impacted. Now going to the tools or maybe resources that are available or used, mostly it is in India, at least all social networking platforms, chat groups. Even you find a lot of phishing via emails, SMS, or some of the special messaging platforms. And social media like Facebook, etc., have a lot of unsolicited friendship requests. And a lot of collaborative online games also have come up, where a lot of people can, or maybe a lot of children can, get together and start play the game, etc. And when we ask why these tools or these mediums are preferred by criminals online, is that there is always a missing component of safety by design in all these tools. There is no proper verification of anyone. Anyone can claim as anyone else and present to the children, and they keep on believing whatever is available to them on the screen. And there's a lot of time that most of these technology companies take to block any questionable posts. Even when there is a demand from some of the established NGO groups, there is always a hesitancy. And most of these now, thanks to the new IT rules that have come up, government of India has been a bit strict on the things, and it took on maybe social networking giants like Twitter in the last month. And otherwise, the response action has been very slow, which has always emboldened the criminals online to take on more than what is possible otherwise. Then coming to the next point, this is regarding regulatory or other related issues. So I'll just mention how can we help control the abuse is the last part of my discussion. One of the most important things is a regular prevention and awareness campaigns for victims, guardians, caregivers, and including law enforcement people. So this can help identify what are probably some of the modus operandi, how did something happen in a different scenarios, how the children should be made aware about some of the challenges that are available online. Then increase education and outreach to children, parents, and community, maybe through NGO groups or child safety strategies. Then ensure that we have multiple hotlines in India. But the challenge is that when somebody in desperate need call a hotline, maybe the number of channels are lesser, and the attending or somebody, whether it is operational or appropriately staffed or someone is giving a response to that, it's always a challenge. So maybe we need to concentrate more on ensuring the hotlines are operational, staffed, and there are enough numbers of channels are available to see that even when multiple people or multiple impacted children or parents, etc., call up, they are getting immediate response. And also, we have in India, multiple state, multiple provinces, and sharing of information between different police agencies or maybe between NGO groups, etc., is very limited. Maybe if they all get together, like something what Guillermo has told, like maybe it's a global problem, it's a borderless problem. So at least within India, this border of between state, provinces, etc., should be completely removed. There has to be some coordinate agency who can give details about different modus operandi and how things are happening, etc. That can also increase to control the abuse. Then increase in transparency and accountability of technology companies. They are normally not so very good, at least from the India perspective, in terms of prevention, moderation, and action taken on report of child sex abuse. And also, it is coming on the very design approach itself. Like many of these tools, anyone can impersonate, and that becomes a major challenge. And last but not least point that I want to mention about is we need to give maybe a specialized support for victims and survivors, and some sort of rehabilitation and settlement to see that all their troubles at least come to an end someday. And with that, I would like to close on my points. And thanks, Lina and team. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mr. Edisari. Thank you. We've learned so much from you, and we continue to learn from you every time you speak to us. Thank you so much. Next, I'd like to invite Ms. Ananya Chakraborty. She's a national award-winning documentary filmmaker and broadcast journalist who specialized in trafficking and other gender issues. She's currently the chairperson of West Bengal Commission for Protection of Child Rights. She's a real-life heroine who saved a woman from getting molested outside a busy Kolkata metro station. Ms. Chakraborty has been a vocal crusader for women's rights and was the first to make a documentary on sexual harassment at the workplace in India. Thank you so much for joining us, Ms. Chakraborty. Welcome.
Thank you so much, Gitanjali. And thank you, Lina, for inviting me to this extremely distinguished panel. The first thing that I would like to say is that while we are working on trafficking, it's very important to again reiterate the difference between migration and trafficking. Because if we only discuss about the perils of trafficking, then, you know, as a result, what happens is that we tend to keep our girls back in villages and in certain countries that, oh, going out means you can fall into a trap, you can get into danger. So we are clipping their wings, the wings of the girl especially. So I am of the very strong opinion that we must also advocate for safe migration. And we must also campaign that there is a difference between migration and trafficking. that all migration does not end up in trafficking, and it's all right to migrate. All of us have migrated from somewhere or the other. My father may have migrated from somewhere. My mother might have migrated from somewhere. No, they were not residents of Calcutta. So tomorrow, my child might want to migrate somewhere else for work. And it is all right. That is how civilization is. That's from the beginning of civilization. People have migrated for a better life. So I feel it's very important to understand that and then go on to the issue of trafficking, that migration has to be safe. How to make migration safe? How to be informed? Informed migration is safe migration, and that does not end in trafficking. So that is the first thing that I would like to reiterate today on the day against trafficking, that we need to make this difference. And also, all trafficking victims don't end up as sex, they don't end up in the sex trade. They can be into labor and all that, and you know, all kinds of places. And also that all sex workers were not trafficked. We also have to understand that. Yes, they had no options, probably. They had no career options, which is why they went into the sex trade, but they were not necessarily all trafficked. So we also need to understand that. The problem today, the biggest problem today, as has been stated, is that trafficking has gone online. It has gone online in a very bigger way from last year. So ever since COVID broke out, there has been online trafficking earlier also, online live streaming. We have had an international conference on trafficking about 4 years ago, 3-4 years ago. That was the first international conference on trafficking in India. We had it in Calcutta, where we had people coming in from 15 different countries and talking about it. And so it had existed already. But this COVID situation gave it a fillip, because has been rightly pointed out, that sexual predators could not travel. So they took use of the social sites, of the online sites, which is how online trafficking has really improved. And I absolutely agree that there is very little information on it and very little awareness on it, on how it operates and how to counter it. So if today, for example, I suddenly find that my photograph is morphed with something, and you know, it's up there somewhere, even I might not know where to go. You know, I might be hesitant on where to go. And imagine a child or a minor. The minor would be very, very afraid. So I think the first thing that we need to do is to raise awareness online sex trafficking and online exploitation, because otherwise I'm sure that it's an invisible crime. You know, it happens in the dark web. We don't know where it happens. We don't know how it happens, because it happens inside a computer, and you can only watch it in a computer or a tablet or your phone. So it's very difficult to find them, and then to actually trace it, to go to the police and complain in lodge a complaint in a proper way. We don't have we have very little idea about the laws governing cybercrime. Even the police, even the judiciary is not fully aware. They are being constantly made aware. Even in our country, in Bengal, we have one very good lawyer called Bibhash Chatterjee, who is the best lawyer in cybercrime. And he has 100% success rate. He has managed to get people convicted in cases of cybercrime, 100% conviction. He's excellent, but there are very few lawyers like him. You know, he is very good and he's very honest. But otherwise, it becomes very, very difficult. So I think we must all join hands together, to raise awareness that there is a difference between trafficking and migration, the importance of safe migration, to make children and parents aware that to be very careful on how you use one uses the internet. Now we have to allow the children to allow the internet, to use the internet, because of online classes, and because, you know, we are all segregated in homes and all that. There's no socializing as such. So therefore, the use of internet has gone up, and therefore, and the crime will also go up. So we have to raise awareness there. I don't know how. I don't know how exactly how, except that we have created handbooks. This was, of course, created before COVID, but we have created handbooks in all languages, in Bengali, English, and Hindi, all languages, meaning these three, which is about stay safe online. And we also have some music videos on stay safe online. And we use that extensively. We use the handbook extensively, and we, you know, play the songs. It's available on our social media, and anyone can use it. All our materials are copylefted. So, but we all need to work on it. We all need to raise awareness, starting from home, starting from your own family, that how to make your children more aware, and maybe use children as stakeholders, and use them to train other children, because children often don't like being told by elders that don't do this, don't do that. But if other children tell them, then it's like peer kind of a thing. So then it becomes more acceptable to them. So this is what I wanted to say. If there is anything else later on, any question, I'm very willing to answer. Thank you.
Thank you so much,
Ms. Chakravorty. I'm so glad you stressed on the point that, you know, protecting women and children should not be confused with curtailing their freedom. We completely agree with you. Thank you so much. I'd like to invite our next speaker, Mr. Shekhar Mehta, the Rotary International President 2021. A Rotary member since 1984, Mr. Mehta has served as the director, member, and chair of several committees. He's also the chair of Rotary Foundation India. He's the architect of the TEACH program, which promotes literacy throughout India and has reached thousands of schools. Mr. Mehta has received Rotary's Service Above Self Award and the Rotary Foundation's Citation for Meritorious Service and Distinguished Service Award. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you. Thank you so much. First of all, thank you, Lina, so much for inviting me to this very important discussion on a very important day that we all need to take note of. I'm sorry, I'm having to speak from the car because the place where I came, I've not been able to get out, and I'm running low on battery, phone battery, my dongle battery. So sorry to interject and come early on. I'll just speak and I'll have to leave, not even wait for any Q&A. I'm so sorry, Lina, but probably for another day. But I'm very happy that this event is being organized today. I've seen your passion from day one, probably, how passionate you have been for the cause. And it is a cause which probably has reached bigger dimensions in today's environment. The pandemic has led to a higher rate of human trafficking. And it's good that on World Day Against Trafficking in Persons that we are discussing these issues. As it is, during the pandemic, the people who otherwise are disadvantaged or discriminated, they are the worst affected people during the pandemic. As it is, their vulnerability gets compounded during such periods. And predators find it much more easy. They find ways to exploit at such situations. Also, the pandemic has led to people's economy go haywire, absolutely. The poor people do not have access to work at times. They are not getting paid. They are having to go back home. And that's not helping their economy at all. And for economic reasons at times, the trafficking is increasing. The worsening economic situations, social effects, all of this is leading to higher growth in trafficking. And I mean, 65% of the people who are getting trafficked are women and children. And it so happens that for the current year, Rotary, the worldwide, the overarching theme is empowering girls. And I'm so happy that we are discussing this issue today. Rotary would be very happy to work with Missing anywhere that we can, Lina, because this is the focus area. And 4,000 plus Rotary clubs, 1,75,000 Rotarians in India, and about 1.2 million across the world in 200 countries are all working towards empowering girls, trying to do different things, trying to ensure their education. Well, for a long term, I think education is the best thing that we can do, creating awareness, telling people that how you may be trapped into such situations. If they understand vulnerable people, I think they will be better equipped to be able to stall trafficking. So education is one area where we are working very deeply, trying to send back children who drop out of schools. There are special programs for helping girls especially. There is a program, Asha Kiran, where we have sent out children who drop out of school. We send them back to school. Also ensuring that they do not drop out of school. I mean, such an important thing, creating toilets in their schools, gender segregated, adequate toilets. Toilets, they drop out of school. When they drop out of school, knowledge is less. Ghar mein income chahiye, more prone to getting trafficked, especially the poor families. So, you know, these are things which will have long-term effect, but this menace is not going to go away in a day or two also. We will have to strike right at the roots, and probably the root cause, the biggest way, I think, would be educating people and making them aware. Absolutely.
Yes.
Education is extremely, extremely important. And I am so very happy that you've taken up this program of MASP. And yes. Lina, it dovetails very well into the program of e-learning that we have. Now, it so happens the e-learning program is where we have created audiovisual content for NCERT, and right from class 1 to class 12, it has been given to NCERT free of cost. There are about 2,000 videos that we have created, half an hour episodes, and given to NCERT. And this is being seen by more than a crore children every day on the Prime Minister E-Vidya channels, PM E-Vidya channels, class 1 to 12, as well as on the Diksha portal. Now we are getting into each and every state. For example, Punjab, every school that has a television, this content of that we have created is there. Similarly, for Sikkim, every school will have it. Just 2 days back, we signed an MOU with them. Very soon, we'll be signing an MOU with Arunachal Pradesh and different states. 2 days back, I met the Chief Minister of Uttar Pradesh. He's very keen that we do this in Uttar Pradesh, all of Uttar Pradesh. So thousands and thousands of schools, if not lakhs of schools, will be able to access. So that can be a wonderful place for you to house content that you want children to know. Class 8 ka content, class 8 students dekh sakenge, and students who are in class 12 will be able to see content that is in 12. So awareness creation amongst children, probably this will be one of the best ways that you can do. And you are more than welcome. Rotary will only be happy to get this content loaded onto the content that we already have. For example, in Sikkim, the 1,000 schools, the televisions that are going, at the factory level itself, the entire content is getting uploaded there. So if these, you could get these content converted into episodes, and you know people at Rotary India Literacy Mission very well. You yourself are a Rotarian, so it's very easy for you to get this done. If you get it uploaded there, it'll reach out to lakhs and lakhs of students. So this is, I find there is a synergy where Missing and Rotary can work together. If there is anything else that we could do, very recently, we've started a program called Virangana, where girls are being given training in self-defense. Next time koi abuse karne aaye, rape ke liye try kare, to uske pehle do char khaye to sahi kam se kam. Yes, and seriously.
I've already tried to apply that for Sundarbans, yes.
Wonderful, very nice, absolutely. And he is, in fact, just today I spoke to Prabir Chatterjee. I've invited the two ladies, Sangeeta Jain, maybe she's attending, because I sent message to Prabir to get Sangeeta Jain and another lady who is working for this program they called Virangana. And Sundarbans mein hi wo kaam karne ke liye. He's spoken to the SP and he's going on Tuesday to Sundarbans and meet the SP and working with the police there. They are trying to get this program done. Any other thing that we can do here or anywhere in the world that you would want, Lina, Rotary will be very happy. This is our focus area and you are special. We will be very happy to work with you.
So I know, Shekhar, you have to leave. So I'm going to just interrupt Gitanjali the flow just to tell Shekhar Shekhar, you'll be happy to know that I remember 4 years back you invited me on the Rotary India Literacy Mission Dais in Chennai. We've come a long way since then. And now we have this full-fledged Missing Awareness and Safety School program, which I know you cannot watch here, but I'll share with you later. And actually, I wanted you here to see that the length and the breadth of the issue, because we have our panelists from the state, from the international space, from cybersecurity. And these are the kind of people whom we are dedicatedly working with, getting inputs from, and we've been fleshing out this program. And it's very action-oriented. It's actually totally in line with everything whoever said out here. And you are here because I know that you have always been there and you want to do, you really want to create a different and empowered women, like you're saying, for this year. And so we'll be really happy to take on your offer. And I'll be then, of course, sending you all a proposal. I would really like to hope to see this integrated into the TEACH, the RILM, sure, and all your literacy programs across Rotary.
Absolutely. Absolutely. We'll be delighted to.
Thank you so much, Shekhar. Thank you so much. And thank you so much for taking time out in the middle of everything and doing it.
I'm so sorry that this has happened. I had blogged normally. It doesn't happen that I don't come to a meeting, but I got stuck somewhere and I couldn't. And a beach mein se meeting mein maine kaha, this is important. I have to go. Rotary hota to main idhar udhar kar deta, but it was you. I wouldn't want to do that. Thank you so much, all panelists. Excusing myself from all of you. I heard Ms. Chakravarti, that was wonderful. She is an excellent resource to work with, and I'm sure so are the other panelists.
Yes.
We all need to work together. Thanks.
Thank you so much. Well, that takes me to our next speaker, Dr. Sarfraz Khan. He is a faculty member of WBNUJS and former director SLS Hyderabad. He has almost 2 decades of experience as a law teacher and researcher. He has authored and co-authored many manuals and research papers on combating human trafficking. He's been awarded many scholarships and fellowships, including the International Visitors Leadership Program Fellowship by Department of State of the United States of America on anti-human trafficking. Welcome, Dr. Sarfraz Khan. Is it my internet?
Sarfraz, you'll have to unmute yourself. We can't unmute you.
I think there's an issue.
Yeah, I think, Lina, there's a network issue with him. He's coming on and off on the screen.
You want to sign in again? I think if he signs in again. Sarfraz, you want to try in by signing in again? Okay, there's a network issue on his end, is it?
I think so.
So,
Yeah, he's back, I think, now. Maybe we could just give him another minute to see if he's able to join. If not, we can move on to some questions.
We can take some questions. Meanwhile, one question, Gitanjali.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. Okay. I just wanted to see if he could come back. Okay. So maybe we could, since I think Mr. Guillermo went first, maybe
he's
we could
here. Ask. I think Sarfraz is okay. Here. He can. Yeah, Sarfraz, I think now you've unmuted yourself.
Okay. Am I audible?
Yes.
I think it's lots of connection issue. So good afternoon to everyone. Basically, today on these occasions, the few pointers on which I really want to discuss is one about what's most significantly about the how to increase the reporting of crimes and what kinds of a role the awareness can play. But before going into it, late in few minutes times, we can cover two more things which I want to discuss. One, that is still in the laws which we are there, in ITP, etc. There are with a gap in respect of the demand side, addressing the demand, whether it's a demand for sex trafficking, demand for labor, demand for so demand side or customer procurement side, those that has not, law has not addressed. Some of the bill which was there is also incomplete. So we apart from that, this is a requirement improvement in the law. But at the same time, we also require how the within the existing framework, how the reporting will increase. For instances, we call this a huge, we call dark figure of crime. So there's a huge number of gaps that exists between the number of offenses committed in India and the numbers of reported by the police agency. So we see a NCRB data talk about this number of cases. Sometimes we become very assertive that why the number has increased. But number has increased in the NCRB data, it is also a sign that the peoples are agreeable to report. So there's a much more awareness at the grassroots level. More and more people are going to report the crimes, and the dark number of the dark percentage of dark figure of crime will decrease. So we know in many part of the world, in some places it is says that only 15% of the offenses which committed are being reported. Some place, some reports suggested globally 40% cases are reported. In India also we find a huge gap between the, when we see the report which comes from the Ministry of Health, or when we see the report which comes from the NCRB data. So there are violence at home, violence at other places, but when we see the prosecution, it's a very small number of cases. So it's a huge gap between the offenses which is being committed, children which is victimized. In fact, a million of cases every day in the difficult situation where children are in sex trafficking conditions, where the children are in different red light areas. Every day there are rapes, and we are tolerating it. We are not recognizing it. We are not reporting in which it can. I have done a research work just 2-3 years ago, and it's based on 80 case studies. And I was astonished to find that those 80 case studies, my was those where the NGOs were involved, two countries' government were involved, being India and Bangladesh. Despite that, only 52 cases, that means 66% cases, there were prosecution. And still 33% cases, there is no prosecution. Out of these 66% cases, there are only 17 cases where appropriate section of law or ITPA was used. So we have a gap. We have a gaps between, there are less number of reporting, so huge gaps of dark figure of crime. Two, even when there's a reporting, there is no guarantee that appropriate provision of law is being used. So how to fill the vacuum? The vacuum can only be filled if we can reach the awareness or informations about it from the grassroots, starting from the schools to the children, to Aganwadi workers, to the village panchayat, and everyone must be know about it. So as soon as we can increase the awareness, I think that will be a great tool to addressing the issues, to reduce the your dark figure of crime, as well as filling the gap. So improvement we can always bring in the law, but more than improvement, whatever the existing mechanisms are there, are those being utilized? Are we are using them? Is there a number of FIR is being registered in the cases? When the FIR is registered, are they using appropriate provision of the law? Because I know several cases where police happy to register FIR in IPC, but they don't touch ITPA, they don't touch bonded labor, they don't touch child labor. So there is a gap between, we file satisfaction by the number of fire, but their gap exists in the using the appropriate provision of law. And I think these initiatives of creating more awareness can go a long way in addressing the issues. So that's basically a few words which I wanted to discuss today. Thank you.
Right. Sarfaraz, that was very short. Anything else? I know you're very passionate about the issue and you've written multiple. In fact, you've gone deeper into also certain incidences. Like I remember your insights into the red light being the first, the most open illegal space in a city and things like that, which...
That's true. So like recently one paper which I have seen, which is under process of publications, where I use the word, what we require is from change from tolerance to intolerance in respect of the sexual violence against children, particularly in the red light areas. And what I have seen that the amount of violence which taken place even in the worst kinds of scenario in the world. So when we have war in some countries where the armed struggles are there, even in those circumstances, the figure which we find about the number of sexual offenses, a much higher figure we find in the red light areas in India. These figures are, in real time, I say, dark figure of crime. And somewhere it becomes a tolerable effort for us. Because say even smaller are red light areas in a country, where even if these are 20 girls are there and 10 customers uses them, these are 200 rape legally speaking, 200 rape under the IPC or POXO is being committed every day. And this figure is a dark figure of crime. Nobody, we don't talk about it. Or we, even if we do, we don't know how to deal with it, because these are little chances to getting reporting of it, little chances to getting a prosecution of it. To the another thing is about the bill which came recently. Still, we require these lots of struggle which we have to face. Till the time we able to address the issue of demand in India as well as in other places, we will not able to see or end these exploitations at any places. Particularly in sex trafficking, still we don't have law drafted in such a manner which can going to address the demand. Neither is not there in the ITPA, nor the bill has prescribed. Experience shows that the countries where the demands are there, the number of trafficking has decreased. Even there are some research where the traffickers interviews published, and the traffickers said that, look, we don't traffic in this country because this country become not a good market today because the prosecution has started against the customers. As soon as the prosecution started against the customers or the demand creators, the number decreases, the relate areas shrink. So it has an adverse impact. At the same time, it will, apart from this, there's another challenge will come. How to deal with the people who are there already in the red light districts or who want to withdraw themselves, what kind of a rehabilitation mechanism we can give, what support system should be there from the state. So my own feeling is that in trafficking cases, particularly if you see the sex trafficking cases, we need to address demand one side, other side we need to address the vulnerability. When we need to address the, and both should go simultaneously. It cannot be one after another. So it's not that we can pass a law against the customer and we are not talking anything about the rehabilitations, reintegrations, preventions, giving support system, creating a supportive environment for the children who are there. So in this mechanism also, I think there's a lots of scope for improvement. ITPA bill, which was there in 2006, it has a specific provisions. I don't know when the new bill came into, it has not used the same language. IPC when came into existence, I rarely find in IPC 370 we feel some satisfaction that it used is defined human trafficking, but it is astonishing that in section 370 IPC, when they defined the term human trafficking verbatim copied from article 3, they deleted four important words and the possession of vulnerability of a victim. Now we all know the trafficking taking place because of the vulnerability, be it the sex trafficking, be it the labor trafficking, be it child exploitation, it's all because of the vulnerability. And suddenly in section 370 IPC, legislature has deliberately omitted that part, these four words, which was most significant of the article 3 of the trafficking protocol. in the current bill which was there, I think that has been taken care of. So they have the provision. So we require to address one side the demand issues. We require to address ITPA, much strengthen ITPA. We require the victim support systems should be available irrespective of the class of the victim, place of the victim, whether it's a victim from India, victim from abroad. If the victims of trafficking are there, they are same, and we require to get the same kinds of protections. There are international obligations on the country and which we require to fulfill. So we cannot bypass those international obligations. Despite we have signed, ratified optional protocol of trafficking protocol, but we have not brought in the law. We feel satisfaction with Section 370 or 370A, which could not be the case for incorporating the entire obligation, which is there in trafficking protocol. So we require lots of changes. But my concern is that to bring these changes, again, we require awareness and much more conscious awareness among the people so that we can raise these issues. In fact, among the parliamentarians, the issue need to be discussed. The parliamentarian must be cautious of the fact. So I don't know when the bill will be placed tomorrow in the parliament in few days time. How many of us really discuss with the parliamentarian in our locality and inform them that, look, these are the things we need to fulfill. And accordingly, they should not allow to pass the bill unless these are the basic requirement of the victims can be fulfilled, demand can be addressed, and the effective protection system should be available. So that's the few things which I wanted to discuss.
Thank you so much. Gitanjali, you want?
Yeah, thank you so much, Dr. Sarfaraz Khan, for giving us your time and sharing your experience and insights. I think all of you sort of really reiterated on why awareness is important and how we need to empower children and adolescents. And so I'm quite happy to, talk about what I'm going to talk about next. As we all look ahead to build on, all our learnings and create a safer world for children, I'd like to share with you Missing's latest effort to prevent trafficking. That's our Missing Awareness and Safety School program. We all know that one in every two children in India is sexually abused by the age of 10. We also know that this is an underreported number. We have the data that says about 180 children go missing in India on an average, many of them trafficked and only about half of them ever really traced. So in our collective fight against trafficking, while we strengthen, the rescue and rehabilitation systems in the country, it's essential to empower the most important stakeholder in this, which is the child or the adolescent. So we're very proud today to share the first of its kind comprehensive safety program, the Missing Awareness and Safety School program, which I'll also refer to as MASP from here on. This program is built on Missing's learnings from the past 5 years, where we raised awareness with more than 130,000 children in India across 15 states. And we've learned a lot from speaking from children, teachers, parents, educators. We've heard directly from them about, their concerns and challenges that when it comes to children and adolescent safety. So together with them, we've created an innovative digital pedagogy to teach and learn what safety is, how to identify instances of abuse and exploitation, and how to report them. So MASP brings together interesting narratives, games, activities to provide immersive and experiential learning. We'd like to introduce our program with a short trailer.
Students of today learn the basics of maths, physics, computer science, art, and other subjects that give them the tools to imagine and build a world they want to live in. Often this education overlooks the tools the students need to build a strong foundation within themselves to lead a safe and secure life. Some fundamental questions for adolescents are never truly addressed. How do I keep myself safe in a rapidly changing world? What does complete freedom from physical and emotional abuse look like? Can I be different from my peers and still be accepted? How much of a role do I play in keeping myself and the others around me safe? The Missing Awareness and Safety School program takes these questions head on. The program, designed with the help of experts, exclusively for adolescents, guides them to answer these questions for themselves. The program is not a collection of cautionary tales, but an integration of essential and actionable information on safety. Students are not expected to be passive learners, but active participants. They share their learnings with their peers and communities and emerge as change agents. The MASP is fun, thought-provoking, and an opportunity for adolescents to come into their own. Enroll for MASP now.
So that was our brief introduction to the program. Our program has 5 modules, each playing a key role in understanding, acting on, and advocating for safety. Awareness 101 addresses the most extreme form of abuse and exploitation, that's trafficking, starting from who can be trafficked, who can be a trafficker, to the role that the public plays in keeping the demand for trafficking alive. The second module, cyber safety, addresses the concerns of adolescents whose lives constantly weave in and out of the online world, from practical information on how to keep themselves safe online to understanding how online exploitation works. The third module, adolescent education, is a comprehensive approach to address adolescent well-being by discussing taboo topics like sex, gender, sexual orientation, and some other less addressed topics such as self-esteem, peer pressure, in a safe space. They can closely examine how each of these can strengthen their own identity or create vulnerabilities that can be exploited. We call these 3 the critical thinking modules. The modules that I'm about to present, we call them creative thinking modules. The critical thinking modules bring adolescents information that they need to keep themselves safe and look at their own experiences critically to protect themselves. We want the participants of the program to truly engage with the learnings around their own safety. We believe that teaching is the best way to learn, and there's no greater way to take ownership of an issue than becoming an active advocate for it. So Create Your Own Board Game module allows each learner to reflect on their everyday actions, as either safe or unsafe. Once they create their own board game with their own rules, they use this as a tool to raise awareness with their peers and their community. Launch Your Own Awareness campaign kindles a change maker within every participant. Each participant has the opportunity to wield the power of online or offline media to launch a campaign to advocate for the prevention of abuse and exploitation. Based on each student's interest, they can create posters, put up street plays, or post on social media to raise awareness. It gives them a sense of ownership of the issue and makes them a spokesperson for every missing child. So MASP isn't just like a collection of bare do's and don'ts that the participants might forget as soon as they can. Instead, MASP is a journey and an experience. Each topic in the program is presented to the participant in the form of an interesting animated video. These videos are short and engaging. Each session of the program has an activity to get participants to look at their own beliefs, biases, and everyday experiences critically. For true immersive and experiential learning, MASP has Missing's innovative digital tools embedded in them. The Missing Game for a Cause that puts each participant in the shoes of a trafficking victim. The Missing Stencil Project, which gives the participants the ownership of the cause by starting a public dialogue. Or the interactive digital comic, Web of Deceit, that takes the participants to the shadows of the online world. The journey of each of these participants is mapped, and at every step, the participant fully understands the progress that they've made and what is it that they're working towards? So when a participant takes a step closer, you know, going from understanding to advocating, they get a badge. These badges reflect the purpose of the program and make it accessible to adolescents. The program is accompanied by an inspiring resource library curated by thought leaders across disciplines. So this is a 15-hour program that can be completed in about 4 months' time by just dedicating 40 minutes a week. Or it can be completed earlier or later, depending on the presence of the preference of the school or the student. Missing's vision is to create a safer world for every child, which means that we need to reach every last child or adolescent in the country with this program. Our strategy to make this a reality is to take an integrated approach to reach those across the digital divide. So we offer this program in three modes, two online modes and one offline mode. Speaking about our first online mode, when the pandemic, you know, limited the way that we interact, teach and learn, Missing adapted by developing a dedicated web application for the program. Our web application allows adolescents with smart devices and internet access to join and participate in the program. The program design keeps in mind, the ease of use that's required, and it involves very little work for our already overburdened teachers. There are also many organizations in the country that are working towards promoting digital access and literacy among adolescents. So Missing will work in partnership with these organizations to deliver the program on a messaging platform like WhatsApp through smartphones and tablets. And there are a majority of adolescents in India who don't have digital access or internet access, and many of them are vulnerable. So MassP can be delivered entirely offline for them. With the help of a school or an organization that works with adolescents, the entire program can be implemented by training the trainers who will use audiovisual screens and other methods to impart this information and knowledge. So this is the program flow for the online and offline modes, where Missing will connect with the school or an NGO. They connect us to the student body through the web app or smartphones for our online mode. And then the school or the students sign up for the web app, and the students participate in the MassP, and we get the activities and in the surveys that we've got embedded through the program, so that we can continue to learn from from their answers and what impact we've been able to create. With offline as well, the flow is similar, where Missing will connect with a school or an NGO, they will train a teacher or a facilitator, and then the teacher or facilitator will conduct the MassP and they'll share their learnings back with us so our program can evolve. So we'll try to make this flow as simple as possible so we can reach as many students as we can. Being the first of its kind program, the MassP makes the commitment to demonstrate that by raising awareness, we can keep our youth safer. That's why the program is embedded with thorough monitoring and evaluation systems to understand the impact of the program and learn how we can make it better. Each point we study is mapped to the mindset shifts that we aim to create on Missing's theory of change. By design, the benefits of MassP will ripple through to the larger world to create a safer world for all. I would like to invite Lina to officially launch this program.
I'd love to get everybody on stage, Gitanjali. Let's get everybody.
Yeah, let's get everybody on.
Yeah. So this is the time where all of us, this is the way we do it online nowadays. So this is the moment where you're all collectively a part of the journey, and each one of you has been with us in the past, and I hopefully in the future too. So it's a pleasure to launch the program with you. Gitanjali, we can have the small gist.
Yes, the launch.
It's a sweet moment for me.
Yeah, for us also.
We've been working on this for so long. And Sebastian knows, Sarfraz knows, Ananya D knows. Guillermo, we have only just started speaking. So I'm really looking forward to seeing where we take this across the world or wherever you think it fits. But because everybody here has spoken about the importance of awareness, right from Sarfraz, though he's talking about hardcore laws, he's talking they are not going to be effective till people don't know about them. Ananya D talks about teaching the children themselves should be teaching. And Ananya D, this is what the program does. It's learning, teaching to teach. So that's the greatest form of reinforcing that they become the spokesperson for their own safety. And I think Sebastian has been in part of our journey from day one, and all his inputs in the cyber safety module have been in this totally invaluable, Sebastian. Guillermo, we would love to give you a proper demonstration, more insights. I know the team is already speaking with us. And if anybody has any questions here, do we have any questions? I know we've run a little over, but I'm sure if there are some nice questions for our esteemed panel, we should take them, Gitanjali. I'd love to hear them talk because they all spoke so little.
We do have some questions. So I'll start with Mr. Gamer because he went first.
Yeah.
You spoke about how NGOs alone cannot, do the work of preventing trafficking, that we have to build a multidisciplinary approach towards tackling the issue. Can you tell us from your experience in training with, private entities, organizations, and schools, how far the impact of education can go, an education program?
Well, I think when we look at multidisciplinary approaches, right? So we have several pillars. We have the justice, which is law enforcement, prosecutors, judges, etc. We have the research and data collection, the academic component. But I think with the education, let's face it, when children go back to school, eventually they will go back to school, they spend most of the time with the teachers, with the counselors. So I think within that frame, we need to make sure that the school systems are aware, the educators are aware of the signs of child sexual abuse, the behavior, the psychological component. Because I think, and no, actually I don't think, there has been a lot of cases where the children are groomed, they're extorted online. And this happens all the time, 24/7. Before, when I was growing up and there was no internet, that extortion, would happen at school, during the lunch break, during the free time. But now it's online and it happens everywhere. As a result of that, because of the children are extorted, the harassment continues to happen online, and a lot of times a lot of children have committed suicide because they cannot take it on. We need to educate the schools of the signs of that type of abuse, the signs of behavior, not only the teachers but the psychology, the psychological team at schools, the social workers, the medical staff at school. So I think that's a very important component, right? And there's within the school systems, there are many different patterns that we could address the education and awareness. Right now we have education programs for schools, for international schools right now, but that's very limited, and I would love to see how we can expand that component to all different types of schools as well.
I hear you, education for all, a particular kind of education for all. Thank you so much. Mr. Sebastian, if I have, maybe have a question for you. Constantly hear about, we hear about the numbers of child sexual abuse material reports and the cases all the time, and it's nothing short of shocking. So given that it's happening online, it's so difficult to trace and prosecute, how can we combat it?
Yeah, I will add to the things that was responded by Guillermo. It is training and awareness, but it's a different type of training and awareness what law enforcement is needed. There's a lot of things that is provided by Interpol. I think ICMC, ICMAC is contributing a lot to the database and such activities. So one thing is, and the most important thing is, how to collect digital evidence which is acceptable in a court of law. Because our law enforcement teams, they many times do a wonderful job of apprehending the criminal. And however, by the time when they present this evidence to court of law, the challenges of digital evidence coming, it is very, the digital evidence can be, what you can say, it can be told that this is tampered, this is placed by law enforcement agency, this is not their own, someone else has done it, someone has morphed it, all these sort of things. So there are appropriate collection methodologies that courts internationally accept as tamper proof and as an evidence of collected in an appropriate manner. There are certain techniques called hashing, etc., at the time of collection and subsequently at the time of presenting at the court of law. This can be masked and confirmed that the evidence that is presented before the court is same what was collected from the scene of evidence. So I think the training, especially on the law enforcement side, especially from the collection of evidence part, that is initial incident response, that has to go much, much more important. That has to get a much, much more important role in the training of law enforcement.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. Ms. Chakraborty, the UN 4P strategy talks about prevention, prosecution, protection, and partnerships. Another P that needs to be a culmination of these four is policy. We would love to understand from you, as somebody chairing a government body focused on child rights, how do you sort of see the future of anti-trafficking efforts on that front?
Well, West Bengal, as you know, has a high incidence of trafficking because so many international borders that we have. There is in trafficking, there's out trafficking, and we all are aware of it, which is why West Bengal was the first state to have a separate directorate on child rights and trafficking. And we have a very active anti-human trafficking unit. We have NGOs and all kinds of people, the police, etc., with the anti-trafficking unit, and they meet regularly to discuss policies and all that. And I've seen how policies have changed. And to give a small example, when I was a filmmaker and I was not in the government, I had visited a few homes for my shooting. And the condition that I had seen then, and there are certain problems that I had seen then, those have been rectified. So I think when a government is willing to work, they can see the policies and they accept that there is a problem and they're willing to change it, it can be changed. This I'm talking about locally. But of course, it's a national issue. So on the national issue, we have to discuss this with the parliamentarian. But from West Bengal, I'm quite hopeful because as a state, I can see that you can make out how seriously the government is considering the problem when you see the budget allocation. That is very important. And West Bengal has an excellent budget allocation, which goes up every year when it comes to social welfare. And trafficking is part of that. So when you take care of social welfare, automatically trafficking will come down. Your social welfare would also, it would also include a bit of health, because primary health and ASHA workers, etc. And when you see that the things like panchayats are working and VLCPCs are being activated, because VLCPCs play a very, very important role in prevention of trafficking, in prevention of child marriage, child labor, etc. And they also have some power. They have some constitutional power, and they can actually prevent things from happening. So I think that at least in West Bengal, the government is going in the right direction. Of course, there are challenges. The biggest challenge is the scale. We have a population of 13 crores. You know, it's a huge, huge population that we are dealing with. And we have more population than three other states put together. So that is the biggest challenge. The other challenge are the so many borders that we are dealing with. But in spite of that, I can see that the department is very active. We have a Directorate of Child Rights and Trafficking, which is very active, which is doing excellent work, constantly training panchayat members, constantly training the police in collaboration with NGOs and all that. So we can see that efforts are on. Of course, it's an ongoing thing. It cannot just go away like that because it's an ongoing problem. Poverty elevation is a very important factor. And things like COVID. And we know it for a fact that in situations like this, when there is a natural calamity or when there is war or there is civil war or there is some kind of a tension, like what happened, a pandemic. In these kind of situations, the traffickers, they get a fillip. You know, it becomes easier for them, so much easier for them to operate. These are the push factors which help the trafficker. And we are going through that right now. And it is a very big challenge, but I am hopeful that at least in our state, we are going to live up to it.
Lovely.
Thank you so much.
Thank you
for sharing that. Dr. Sarfraz, we heard you talk about the bill and its implications and the new recommendations and its limitations. How can we collectively overcome these limitations? What could we do? Maybe you could talk a little bit more about that.
Now, so we have one opportunity in front of us when this bill will be probably again Ministry of Child Development will place in Parliament. So I don't know how we can persuade the different parliamentarians throughout the country, at least few parliamentarians who can put forward our views. Recommendation time is already over. So some of us has given recommendations to the committee. So that's one thing. And then through awareness, through mobilization, through NGOs only, we can recommend to the government that we need a law. More than a stringent law, we must require a law where we can address the issue of punishing the other traffickers along with the demand creators also. So without addressing that, it cannot solve. And parallelly bring the much more mechanisms or adopt best practices. So some of the states the way they has rescued some children in some West Bengal's so the best practices which can be adopted and which ensure that no place for exploitation should remain there. How can perpetually we can have such place of exploitations with impunity where there is no prosecution exists? So we require law. We require also implementation of those legislations. We require law in the same manner for all trafficking victims, irrespective of their place from where they came. Once the child trafficking victims come from the Nepal, Bangladesh, other places, they are trafficking victims, and we do require to take into account those considerations to solve the issue. So, yes, that's again awareness and advocacy that can work.
Okay, that's great. Thank you for sharing that with us. Lina, do you want to talk about MASPI and
Yes. So I'm again expressing my gratitude and thanks for this sweet day when we have launched MASPI and for all of you to be here with us. The MASPI is setting out to do something which is in the very early days when I, as an artist, when I came into a red light district and I met a survivor, she said, I didn't know I could get trafficked. It's a 12-year-old girl, a survivor, whom I met when she was 16. And she said, I didn't know I could get trafficked. And I still remember those words sort of ring in my ears. the lack of awareness and a systematic lack. We can't go in and do one course one day, one year, and then not go back there in that same school the next year, or not reach that particular batch of students saying, in this school, I did it last year, so I won't do it in this year. Kind of a random awareness blanket or net which we kind of throw, and which is done sporadically. I think that's what I realized, that it's so important that it becomes part of a curriculum. Like, and even the whole journey of creating the MASP, I mean, Gitanjali will know. So when we were doing the monitoring and the evaluation, I was saying, no, Gitanjali, how can we make sure that we are not just talking about our impacts, we're talking about more than outcomes, we're talking about what exactly have we taught. We've gone into a detailed theory of change for each of our modules. And we can say, like, I mean, like in a very simple layman language, I said, when a class student goes from class 5 to 6, we are able to say, now that student from class 6 knows multiplication, knows division. Just like that, a child who's done Maths P modules from module 1 to module 2, you'll be able to say, or the child will be proudly able to say, I now know, and they'll wear the badge with pride, I now know how to keep myself safe. I know now how to keep my peers safe. I now know, understand that I have a right over my body. I mean, simple layman's asks and motives and goals, but we are mapping them at every stage of the MASP. And I think it's been a beautiful journey of learning for me, because I'm an artist, but I've entered into a space where we have to show impact outcomes. And my main peeve and cry in the anti-trafficking space is that we get a lot of corporate social responsibility for people who worked on rescue. How many have you rescued? How many have you rehabilitated? How many have you managed to integrate back into the system? But why should we wait for a girl to get trafficked? That's my key motto, which I've been working on. Why do we wait for a girl to get abused, exploited, or trafficked, and then to save her? Why do we have to have that kind of a stamp to show, yeah, I'm doing impactful work? I think awareness demands greater energy and greater collaborations and a systematic awareness. I hope there are more people who do more of such work, because there is lots to do. There are many children to reach. We have to reach every last child in this space. And we've just made the first module, the first version. We hope to keep upping it, keep tweaking it. And I know the team will know that I'm going to be at the back of there. That Gitanjali, you haven't covered this. Gitanjali, you haven't done that. She is the person who's totally at working on the MASP with me. So I'm really happy for what we are setting out to do. And all of you have been there with us. And I hope you all will continue to be there. We will be tapping into your expertise at every point of time. And we really hope to take it far. Thank you so much. Can we have a collective group shot here? I want everybody here. Okay. Thank you so much, Sarfaraz. Thank you, Sebastian.
Thank you.
The rest have left. Thank you so much. Thank you for being here.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks, everyone. Bye. Good day.
Yeah. Bye. Bye.